Good morning. It's great to see you all here this beautiful morning. It's just gorgeous outside. Would you stand with me and we'll start our service with the call to worship. It'll be on the screen. And we're reading from Psalm chapter 62, verses 5 through 8. Please read along with me. Yes, my soul, find rest in God. My hope comes from Him. Truly, He is my rock and my salvation. He is my fortress. I will not be shaken. My salvation and my honor depend on God. He is my mighty rock, my refuge. Trust in Him at all times, you people. Pour out your hearts to Him, for God is our refuge. Let's pray. Father God, we invite you, Father, to be with us this morning in your spirit. May this time be a time of worship to you. And as we open the doors, your church shows up, a church that will withstand all of the powers of hell, Father. We just ask that you would be with us in spirit. I pray that we will be able to put aside all of the things that have taken place this week, all of the things that are ahead of us, and focus our attention on worshiping you. We have come here today for no other purpose, Father, but to worship you. So we ask that our worship would be true, would be pure, and that we pray that you will join with us now and that our worship will be pleasing to you. In thy name we pray. Amen.
As we just read, God is our rock and our salvation. And by saying that he's our rock, that means he's constant, constant through the ups, in the downs, and through trials, and through our victories, throughout everything, God is our rock, and he's constant. So let's, first, before we sing this song, just reflect, is that true in my life? Do I see God as my rock? No matter what happens, can I say it is well with my soul? So let's keep that in mind as we sing this opening song.
Sorrows I see, it goes home.
each other.
When I first heard of the needs of chat, God used that to impact or to touch my heart. There are many tribes in chat, and many of them are still unreached with the gospel. Even in the tribes or the ethnic groups where there is already a church, many children are still unreached. So when we see the map of Chad, we see a country, but we see many nations. And within the nations, there are so many children, which most of them have never had a chance to hear the gospel. There are so many children in Chad, and many of them do not know anything about the Lord. So the idea is to train the teachers for Sunday school so they can reach the children, teaching them the stories of the Bible. Through the year, I travel often to the villages, and there we have a class for teachers for a week. So there are more teachers trained now than before, and there are more children that are being reached by these teachers in Sunday school. So we praise the Lord for that, and we hope that many lives are being impacted by His work. Through Day of Generosity, we are blessed by different offerings from brothers and sisters in other countries, and that helps each of us to increase our support. That means we receive an extra help every year besides our normal support, and that allows us to live and to travel and to teach there in Chad.
So next Sunday, we'll take two offerings. You'll have an opportunity to assist in the spreading of the gospel of Jesus Christ throughout the world. As I said, these local churches in these countries are sending out workers from their own people to share the gospel. These national ministry partners need additional support. And so next week, we will provide you with that opportunity to assist them through a Day of Generosity offering. Welcome to Martinsburg Grace Brethren Church. If you are visiting with us today, please fill out a card in the pew rack in front of you. And by the way, if you're sitting next to someone that you don't know, make sure you introduce yourself. And if they're a visitor, I would hope that you would bring them down to the table in the middle out back here. We have a special gift for them. So just walk them right down following the service. We want to get an opportunity to meet them and to provide them with a gift. Next week, you're reminded that it's daylight savings time. So don't forget to turn your clocks back 1 hour, correct? Do I have that right? It's back 1 hour, right? I got it wrong last time, but I got it right this time. All right, so if they don't, they'll arrive here an hour early, correct? You get to see praise band practice. So if you forget, you'll get here an hour early, get to see the praise band practice. That's exciting. But anyways, you'll get to see them. And then the service will follow eventually 1 hour later because you'll get here a little bit early. Thanksgiving outreach is rapidly approaching. I'm not sure if you know what we do. We basically look to assist individuals within the community, providing them with a Thanksgiving meal, those that are less fortunate. And so each year we provide Thanksgiving meals to those that are in need. Here's a little video clip, if you guys will dim the lights and run that, as to some of the things that they're looking for.
Live from Martinsburg, Pennsylvania, shot in front of a fake studio audience, it's time for Church Family Feud. Here's your host, Sean Not-So-Harvey.
Welcome, folks. Boy, do we got us a good one here. We got returning from Martinsburg, PA, the staff at MGBC. Yes, family, the Robertsons. You know them as Duck Dynasty. Our returning champions, the MGB staff, we have
Pastor Brian McCall.
All right.
Danny Worden.
He kind of looks like Carl.
Shirley Stoltz. Yeah. Rachel Collier.
And I'm the janitor.
Okay, if we have any spills, we got a janitor. And our guest family today is the Robertsons, and you are
Phil.
Miss K and Bobo.
Oh, Miss K and Bobo. Bobo doesn't bite, does he?
Yeah.
Okay.
I'm Willie.
Jace, boom.
I'm Cy.
Come again?
I'm Cy.
Okay, and that's Robertson's. Okay, give me Brian, give me Phil. I'll ask you a question. First one to hit the buzzer and give the correct answer either gets to play or pass. We surveyed 100 people who attend MGBC. Your top 11 answers are on the board. Name something the outreach needs for Thanksgiving. Pastor
mashed,
Brian?
Mashed potatoes.
Mashed potatoes. Phil?
Gravy.
Gravy. Gravy's a better answer. Would you like to pass or play, Phil?
Play. Or playing.
Okay, that's a good answer, Phil. Now to you, Miss Kay.
My sweet potato pie, and you can find it in my recipe book.
Okay, this is a game show, not an advertising station, but sweet potato pie! Ding, ding, sweet potatoes. We'll take that as an answer.
Well, Sean, I think I'm going to go with Miss Kay's muscadine jelly.
You going to do what? What? Is that even a thing? Muscadine jelly.
Mr. J's.
I say frog legs.
Frog legs. What kind of Thanksgiving do you people have in the South? What is going on? Frog legs. Now everybody knows Silas Robinson. Boy, you funny. We surveyed 100 people who attend MGBC. Name something the outreach needs for Thanksgiving.
Sean, I'm going to say iced tea.
You didn't say iced tea, did you?
Yes, I did.
Iced tea, okay. Iced tea.
The MGBC staff has a chance to steal the game if they can guess an answer on the board.
Pastor Brian, for the steal and the win.
This might be a stretch, but I think we need turkeys.
Turkey.
Yeah.
Now that's a good answer. Yeah. I don't know what they eat down south, but that's a good answer. Yeah. Turkey. That's the number one answer. You steal, you win. And the remainder of the answers were number two. Stuffing. Number four was corn. Seven was cranberry. Eight was pumpkin pie. Nine's green beans. Ten's a roasting pan. That makes sense. Cooked turkey in. And number 11 is delivery people. Which I feel as though that should be number one, because without the delivery person, the outreach program wouldn't happen. And that's all for Family Feud. We thank you and catch us next time. Thanks for joining us, Robertson family.
Seriously, folks, last year we did 30 families. This year we'd like to do a lot more. So we really need your help and your support in getting this program off its feet. Remember that the drop-off point is outside the worship center in the lobby. So when you bring your stuff in, delivery will be on November 22nd. We really need your help and your support to get this program done this year. So everybody, don't be a slacker. Be willing to help. Everybody needs to step up this time and really help us make this a good program. And remember, have your pet spayed or neutered. Oh, don't forget the turkeys. Remember last year's turkey? It wasn't quite ready. Well, we think we might have fattened him up a little bit. Let's see. Well, maybe not.
As a video said, check your bulletin. There's a complete list of some of the items that the outreach team needs in order to carry out a successful Thanksgiving meal to those in need. So make sure that you check through that. Last week, I talked to you about the fact that we would go ahead and do a vote for elders. So if our ushers have the ballots, wherever the ushers went to, I guess they're up and about. Okay, yeah. So the ushers are going to come forward, and they're going to hand out a ballot. If you are a member of Martinsburg Grace Brethren Church and are over the age of 15, you must be 15 years of age and older and a member of Martinsburg Grace Brethren Church. If you would raise your hand, these men will give you a ballot, and as it comes back through, the ballot merely indicates check yes or no with respect to supporting these two gentlemen, Dave Cunningham and Randy Huntsman, to come on to the elder board. As I indicated last week, we want to try to provide a smoother transition for new men coming on to the elder board, and because there's just a lot going on, and we want to make sure we get a good transition there. So I'm going to continue with the announcements as you go ahead and cast your ballot. Once you do that, check yes or no, then if you would just merely pass them towards the center aisle. Check yes or no, fold it once, twice, and then pass it towards the center aisle. That would be great. The Reverb Overnighter. Departure times and location for the Youth Reverb Overnighter are in your bulletin. Please read through that for the locations and the times in which they'll depart. If you have not, very important here, if you have not completed an emergency contact form for this event, an emergency contact form. If you haven't completed one, go to the youth page on the MGBC website and complete that form. All right, make sure that you complete the form, the emergency contact form. You need to do that this week because it's this weekend coming up, correct? Is that correct? No, the following? 2 weeks? Okay, so you have two. Still do it this week, but you have 2 weeks to do it, but still do it this week. All right. Thanks to all of you who signed up to assist with Treat Street. Looking forward to Treat Street this week. All volunteers are asked to arrive here at the church 5:30 p.m. Thursday night. That's 5:30, all volunteers. If you have questions, see Jerry Roth. The doors to Treat Street will be open from 6 to 8 this Thursday. Make sure that you invite neighbors and a friend. Bring them along with you. Quiz rally. We have 20 kids competing this Saturday at 9:30 a.m. here at Martinsburg Grace Brethren Church. They have worked hard and memorizing and studying Revelations 1 through 6. Revelation 1 through 6. Let's plan on coming out and supporting the kids. Just as a side note to that, remember next Saturday here, 9:30, a quiz rally. But as a side note, we will begin next week a study of the seven churches of Revelation from Revelation chapters 1 through 3. So I would encourage you to be reading through that as we begin that series next Sunday. Finally, sign-up sheets for Make It, Bake It, Grow It, Sew It are at the information desk. It's a fundraiser here at the church, and there's a sign-up sheet at the information desk, Make It, Bake It, Grow It, and Sew It. Okay, and I think we've got all the ballots passed into the center there. If I could have Carrie Russell and the elders, if you would be willing to come forward. Carrie will be leaving. When are you leaving? This afternoon. To head to the Philippines. She will be working in an orphanage in the Philippines, and we wanted to bring the elders forward to pray over her, and I'm going to shock Skip by having him go ahead and pray over her. There's a, we got Matt coming up here yet. Any final announcements or any other information you need to make them aware of, just continue to pray for her, but we're going to pray over her here this morning. So Skip, if you would lead us.
Lord, we just thank you so much for this morning. We thank you for Carrie and just her willingness to serve you in the Philippines. Just a great opportunity that she has to go over there and just impact the lives of these children that are coming to the orphanage. God, we just pray for protection for her physically, spiritually, from attacks from the evil one. And just as she's there, God, we just pray that she can just grow closer to you and just help raise up these little kids, find them good Christian homes, and while they're there, just love them, show them the love of Jesus as she's there, God. So we just pray for safety and travel as she's there, and we just pray and thank you for the opportunity our church has to be a part of sending out one of our own to the Philippines to impact the world. So God, we just ask these things in your name. Amen.
Amen. Thank you very much. If the ushers would come forward, we'll go ahead and take this morning's offering. We've got the ushers really running around here this morning, asking them to do a lot. Let's pray, please. Ushers, go ahead and come on forward. Father, we would just ask that this morning, as we give back to you a portion of what you have so graciously provided to us, help us to ever be mindful that all that we have, Father, is given to us by you, that you are a loving God, and you shower us with blessings, and you shower us with gifts. And we thank you and praise you for that. And we pray that as we give this back to you, that you will multiply it to this church, to reach this community, and ultimately to the world in the sharing of the gospel of Jesus Christ. So, Father, we provide this back to you and give this back to you and pray that you will bless it. And we are just so gracious and so thankful for what you have provided in your grace. In thy name we pray. Amen.
So as we read together at the beginning of the service in our call to worship, God alone is our rock, and he's our salvation. He's constant through ups and downs, trials, victories, through everything. And that's going to be the theme of our worship set this morning as we sing the next three songs before Pastor Bob comes and shares with us. So we'll wait till the offering plates get to the back. Once they're in the back, we'll stand together, but let's sing together.
Thank you. long to rise to you. When temptation comes my way, when I cannot stand up for you, Jesus, you're my purpose to teach my song to rise to you.
Father, teach us to rely on your promises. You never let go when the things of this world seem to overrun us, when Satan seems to be having his way and temptation falls upon us. May we call upon you. Never once, Father, never once have you left us. You've promised to be with us. We ask that you would help us to be mindful of that. As your servant comes this morning, and Pastor Bob brings the word, I pray a blessing upon him. May his words be your words. We ask this in the name of your son. Amen. Children, you are dismissed through those doors over there. Sir, do you have a preference as to which you would like, sir? No? Take that. Monday, Tuesday, and Wednesday this week, I was in Ocean City at the our district fellowship conference, and I asked Pastor Bob if he would be willing to fill the pulpit this Sunday, and he said he would be willing to do that so that I had a short prep week, and I appreciate him doing that. This morning, though, he asked me if I would give him a flowering, overwhelming, long, and exceedingly gracious introduction. He asked me if I would say something good about him, and I said, well, it's rather short notice. I'd need a little bit more time. Nothing was popping into my head immediately, and so I guess the only thing that I can say is that I greatly appreciate his mentorship. You have no idea how he has assisted me in the process over the last couple of years and prior to that when he was an associate pastor here. And he also was gracious enough to speak kind words about me during the ordination service in which he preached then. So we would ask that you would come and share what God has laid on your heart with respect to when God abandons you in Psalm 22. So, Pastor Bob, thanks.
Thank you.
Is everything okay up here the way you want it?
I don't see any hamburgers, but it'll be all right, yeah.
Okay. If you need something to put your water on,
I'll be okay. Well, I have to say to you that I am so humbled to be here. I'm sitting here listening to the great worship, the singing. Our heart was touched by that, just the praise band and all that they do. It helps us to set the stage for our time in the Word. But I got to tell you that this responsibility is heavier than you can imagine, and I feel that more all the time. You'd think that after all these years, I wouldn't have quite that kind of a burden, but it's a burden that really grows greater because I'm so aware of the many needs in the world, many needs in hearts and lives of people locally in our community, and yes, even within our local church. So I come with a bit of trepidation and asking God that by His Spirit, I might be able to share with you some things that He has been teaching me. I want to begin by reading two passages of Scripture. You don't necessarily need to turn to these, but listen carefully and see if you can grasp the central point out of these verses that I will be pushing on in our discussion today about abandonment by God. The first passage is Hebrews 13:5. Keep your lives free from the love of money and be content with what you have, because God has said, never will I leave you, never will I forsake you. That is, of course, taken. It's a quotation from Deuteronomy chapter 31, verse 6. God's promise to ancient Israel as they were preparing to go into the promised land. Be strong and courageous. Do not be afraid or terrified because of them, that is, the inhabitants of the promised land, for the Lord your God goes with you. Now get it? He will never leave you nor forsake you. And then I think over in the New Testament, the words of Jesus in giving what we call the Great Commission, Matthew 28, 19, and 20. He says, you recall, at the very end of that commission, He says, and behold, I am with you always, always, to the end of the age. Those are precious promises about the abiding presence and the never-ending extravagance of grace that He brings into our lives. But I would ask you now to turn to Psalm 22, if you have not already done so. Psalm 22, and we want to try to follow in the spiritual saga of David, the psalmist, in this passage. My God, why have you forsaken me? Why are you so far from saving me from the words of my groaning? Now, in light of what we've said so far, we even sang a chorus a while ago that was just fabulous about the abiding presence of God. And in the light of those verses that I read just a moment ago, it may seem a bit odd that here is none other than David saying, God, why have you forsaken me? We kind of feel like whatever the Bible may say about the abiding presence of God, David's not feeling that right now. Have you ever been there? In this moment of time, as David writes as a poet, he feels like God has walked out the door, slammed it behind him, and he hasn't been heard from since. This is not a spiritual high time for that great man of God, David. Remember, he's God's chosen man for Israel. His name is celebrated throughout Scripture. A warrior, a statesman, a poet, a musician, a man after God's heart, the Bible says. You can't get much of a better recommendation than that. But nevertheless, as he looks for some telltale sign of God's presence or of God's moving in his life, he's not seeing it. That's our man David. But there is a second question that is posed in this first verse of Psalm 22. He says, why have you forsaken me? And then he says, why are you so far from saving me? Not only does it seem to him that God has disappeared, but that in itself means that David cannot find any deliverance from his trials which are haunting him. And we'll see something about what they were in just a moment. Just at that time when he really needs God's intervention in his life affairs, God seems so far away. His deliverance doesn't even show up at the raw edges. So the suffering continues unabated with no indication or hint that God is ever going to step in, is ever going to bring some deliverance. But then there's a third question here as well. And that question is, why are you so far from the words of my groaning? Why are you so far from the words of my groaning? What I think David is saying in that expression is that, God, why are you so insensitive? Surely from you I could expect a measure of sensitivity, even if you are not going to come in and work within these circumstances which are so troublesome to me. Even so, you could at least give me some indication that you care about what's going on in my life. Three questions. And then we come to verse 2. Oh my God, I cry by day, but you do not answer, and by night, but I find no rest. Now, David, being a man of God, prayed for relief. He sought the presence and power of God through prayer, as we all should. But something has happened. For some reason, even prayer has become, well, like an empty exercise. In this moment of spiritual and emotional emptiness, the prayers seem to just kind of limp out there and drop back down. It wouldn't make any difference if he prayed or not. So he's feeling. And he says that he's been doing this for a while. He says, day and night. Have you ever gone through times in your life where you almost dread the daytime because you're going to be confronted with all these problems and the reality of where your life is at right now, and you can't wait to get to bed, but the night comes and you can't sleep, and it seems like you can barely pray, and so you begin to long for the morning, and it becomes an endless cycle. And so even as David persistently presses his cause before God's throne, he's not really seeing any response from God. You see, what we have in these two verses is what I would call the horrible howl of human misery. It is the picture of human misery in large doses, and no help, no answer, no comfort has been forthcoming. And this being spoken and shared by none other than David, that great man of God, taken from his father's sheep and brought to be the shepherd of ancient Israel. Now let's just stop here for a moment and make a self-check. Just bear with me a little bit. In an audience this size, there are probably a number of us who, quite frankly, feel at home with these first two verses of Psalm 22. For you, too, have been experiencing an unexplainable void of God's presence and intervention into the things that are chewing away at the core of who you are and what you believe and what you want for your life. I'm addressing most of this message to such a person. You are a follower of Jesus Christ. You have in the past found your life in Christ to be meaningful and comfortable and comforting. You have seen spiritual growth in your life too. And that's not bragging, it's just the reality of what you have seen in your life. Since you became a disciple of Jesus Christ, you have found that the Christian experience is far better than anything else that's out there. But for a while now, things have taken a strange turn. There seems to be a mysterious current of spiritual dullness in your life. You find worship less than satisfying, not because it's anybody's fault. It's just, you just know that it's not ringing your bell like it once did. And prayer seems futile, even though you keep on trying to faithfully come before the Lord every day in prayer. And you're really wondering, is there something drastically wrong with me, spiritually speaking? What's happened? And like David of old, you speak to yourself in your thoughts the three questions. God, why have you abandoned, why have you forsaken me? And God, when are you going to do something to fulfill my needs and help me to break through this strange time of silence? And thirdly, don't you even care anymore? Isn't there some hint, some fragment of tenderness that you might extend to me that would at least let me know that they're alive and well and that you care about me? I believe that there are probably some here who can identify with that. The hitch here is, not many of us are going to stand up in a church service and give a testimony and say, I just want to say today that I believe the Lord has abandoned me. I don't see any deliverance coming. I don't think God even cares about me anymore. Do you ever hear a testimony like that? I don't know, maybe I have, but I don't remember it. It just doesn't seem quite proper to stand up in a church meeting with all of our dear friends who are so well-groomed and smell good and everything. They're there in for you to admit such a paucity of spiritual richness, well, it just doesn't seem right. So I'll just keep my mouth shut. Yes, others may speak in glowy, happy terms about their answers to prayer and deliverances that God has brought to their lives. But for you, the silence of God has been deafening. And this kind of condition is not merely some unrelenting physical pain, though that certainly can be involved. And it's not just the dozens of crushing issues which seem to pile on us in this time. But all of this has become a challenge, especially in the arena of faith. If God is there, is God there? And if He is, why this silence? Now let's move on in verses 3 through 5. Yet you are holy, enthroned in the praises of Israel. In you our fathers trusted. They trusted and you delivered them. To you they cried and were rescued. In you they trusted and were not put to shame. Now, what David is doing here is turning on the History Channel. And he looks back at the history of God's dealing with his ancient people, the Jews. And he can see that God has, in fact, been good to Israel. So David's theology has not really changed in this experience he's having. He thinks back and on a national level, he can see that when Israel put their trust in God, God came through for them and brought them many deliverances. And, of course, you know what many of those were. It's a great part of the history of the Old Testament. But now, let's go on to verses 6 through 8, where this becomes personal once again. Looking first at the national situation, but now he comes back to himself, which is what we always do when we're talking about spiritual things. But I am a worm and not a man, scorned by mankind and despised by the people. All who see me mock me. They make mouths at me. They wag their heads. He trusts in the Lord. Let him deliver him. Let him rescue him, for he delights in him. That's kind of a strange expression. I'm a worm and not a man. And I know that there is a kind of approach to Christianity that says, don't ever call yourself a worm. Think of all the things you are in Jesus Christ and all the things that He has given you. Well, I can't argue with that, but at the same time, I don't think it's right to pretend that emotionally we're experiencing something we are not experiencing. Better be honest with God because He knows the truth anyway, right? Everything for the psalmist right now, as he writes, is topsy-turvy. And now we learn in these verses something about what's been bugging him. Unjustified attacks on his credibility and genuineness as God's man is rudely and loudly questioned by his enemies. It's kind of like, hey, you always claim to be a man of faith. You always presented God as one you were trusting in. Well, why don't you let God come now and deliver you? This sneering, mocking public ridicule has no basis in fact. But the attacks, what am I doing?
A
Okay, maybe that'll do better. Okay, I'm sorry. I didn't let somebody wire me up today. When I wire myself up, why, that's the kind of thing that happens. Now, there's an old saying, you've heard it a million times, sticks and stones will break my bones, but names will never harm me. You think David would have agreed with that? In this psalm, he's talking about what people are saying. They are mocking. They're wagging their heads. He is scorned by others. I want to tell you, if that goes on long enough and is widespread enough, it would do you in. It really would. So, the challenge is here for David. Now, there's two lines of thought that I would like to suggest here that I think we need to resist. When we're in this kind of a funk, there's two lines of thought that need to be resisted. The first one is probably not all that hard to resist, and that is God does exist. Or doesn't exist. In this frame of mind, you might begin to suspicion that God doesn't exist, or if he does, he really doesn't have the power to do anything about my problems anyway. You remember back about 15, 20 years ago when Rabbi Harold Kushner wrote the book, When Bad Things Happen to Good People? He said a lot of interesting things in that book, but part of his thesis was that sometimes things are such a mess in this world, there's nothing God can do about it. Man, if that were true, I think I'd go home and take a nap. We must remember that our emotional highs or lows do nothing to change the reality of God's existence, his power, and his nature. We, the clay, cannot really say to the potter, who of course is God, why have you made me this way? Remember reading that? And sometimes we do that, don't we? God, I wish I would have been a little taller. I could have, you know, that would have been nice. Or I wish I had a good singing voice. Oh, that's right, he gave me a good singing voice. I just haven't used it yet. What are you laughing about, Tom? Now, you see, the skeptic would think this way. The skeptic would. Has it ever dawned on you that a true atheist can never be disappointed with God? Well, the second line of thought to resist is, and this touches us a little more pointedly, I believe, God apparently loves selectively. Some are in, some are out. He chooses, some get the riches of his love and blessing, and some do not. In this psalm, David feels himself somewhere way down the list of godly people and God's favored ones. And yet, even he knows that that's not true. You see, we cannot get God to love us more, nor can we cause him to love us less. God's eternal evenness, if I may use that word, I tried to think of another word. God's eternal evenness never changes. He is a constant. And he's not only a constant in a broad general sense, but he is a constant as he interacts with us in our lives. Now, there's something else in this passage that seems to be a diversion. It seems to be tangential to what we've been talking about so far, but it really isn't. Let's go down to verse 14. Okay, Mr. Brian, what? I am poured out like water, and all my bones are out of joint. My heart is like wax. It is melted within my breast. My strength is dried up like a potsherd, and my tongue sticks to my jaws. You lay me in the dust of death. Now read on, verse 16, for dogs encompass me, a company of evildoers encircles me. Now I want you to pay note to a couple of phrases here. They have pierced my hands and feet. Now wait a minute. He's concerned about the derision that has been heaped upon him. He is a leader of his people, and yet this must be a large group of people who are spurning him, turning from him, mocking him. And he says, they have pierced my hands and feet. Well, now I know this is poetry, but you have to be careful that when you study poetry, particularly in the Psalms, that you don't throw out everything that you don't understand as a mere poetic license. All right, let's read on. Verse 17, I can count all my bones. They stare and gloat over me. They divide my garments among them, and for my clothing they cast lots. Pierced my hands and feet. Bones sticking out. And dividing garments by casting lots. I know that being the astute Bible scholars you are, I can see it written in your face, that rings a bell with you. You say, yeah, there's something over there in the New Testament where these words are actually quoted. Would you turn with me, please, to John chapter 19? This is the account of the crucifixion of Jesus. And let's read verses 23 and 24. John 19, 23 and 24. When the soldiers had crucified Jesus, they took his garments and divided them into four parts, one part for each soldier. Also his tunic, but the tunic was seamless, woven in one piece from top to bottom. So they said to one another, let us not tear it, but cast lots for it to see whose it shall be. This was to fulfill the scripture which says, they divided my garments among them, and for my clothing they cast lots. There's the connection between the crucifixion of Jesus and the lament of David in Psalm 22. I don't know that David fully understood what would follow in the light of these words that he wrote, but Jesus, or John, I should say, takes these words of the psalmist and makes this giant leap from the anguish of David over to the anguish of the crucified Christ, who was in fact hands and feet pierced. And here we find that you talk about an indignity. Your haters even take your garments and cast lots for them. Christ was bearing the weight of our sin on himself, and he felt abandoned. Remember those words from Matthew 27? You don't need to turn to it. Eli, Eli, lama sabachthani. My God, why have you forsaken me? Remarkable, isn't it, that even God himself in Jesus Christ felt the same forsakenness, the same abandonment that David felt. Jesus is sometimes referred to as the Son of David. Now, was David abandoned? Was Jesus abandoned? No, not really, in both cases. For David could eventually say, as he does in verses 23 and through 26, "For he has not despised or abhorred the affliction of the afflicted, and he has not hidden his face from them, but has heard when he cried to them. From you comes my praise in the great congregation. My vows I will perform before those who fear him. The afflicted shall eat and be satisfied. Those who shall seek him shall praise the Lord. May your hearts live forever." I'm glad that the psalmist gets around to seeing this side of things in spite of the miserable condition in which he began the psalm. So in both cases, David and Jesus, they weren't forsaken. But there's a third case, and that's you. Out of the cauldron of your suffering will ultimately come a shout of victory, a satisfaction that only God can give you. Always in the dark hour and in the time of light, we make him our theme and focus our everlasting hope. Now, I don't know what you may be facing today, but there may be some of you are dealing with a medical diagnosis that's not very good, or it's not very specific. Nobody knows what to do. Or you may be having a brittle relationship that seems like it's never going to be healed. You have a marriage that may be tottering on the ragged edge of failure. Or you may be experiencing economic stress. There just isn't enough money to go around, and the creditors are calling. I don't know, but maybe just now, this morning, you could identify with the psalmist and say, "God, why have you abandoned me? Why have you forsaken me?" And of course, the answer ultimately is, "I haven't, my son, my daughter. You may not hear from me today or tomorrow, but you will hear from me." And so in that light and in that posture, we present ourselves before the Lord in a new way and saying, "God, I'm not feeling emotionally like I wish I could, but I surrender to you. And I give you all these burdens, these trials that seem to be crushing me." Easy? No, it's not easy. And you may have to do that many times. But God, in the end, is faithful. There is an extravagance of his grace that pours out on those who will hang tight with him. Heavenly Father, thank you for this time we've spent in the Word. And I pray that we'll draw the connection between David and Jesus in the suffering, and then throw ourselves into that mix and realize that truly you are faithful, and that we can expect grace and mercy and help in our time of need. Amen.
As Pastor Bob was saying, after David's life, he was known as a man after God's own heart. If you want to know ups and downs like we've been talking about, just read through the stories involving David. So many highs, so many lows, but such a great example for us. And the only way that he was able to be known as a man after God's own heart was because he was able to relinquish his own desires, his own wants, his own what he even might even have thought were needs. He was able to look at God and say, hey, here's my heart. You speak into me. You speak into my life as to what is true. And that's what we're going to sing about. So please stand with us as we sing this last song.
Here's my heart, Lord. Here's my
you've shown us. Thank you for your faithfulness. I just pray that as we leave these doors today, we turn our focus to you. We continually remind ourselves that we need to give our lives over to you and our hearts over to you, and have you lead us and guide us. We thank you for the message that you spoke through Pastor Bob today. So today we pray. Amen. You're dismissed.